Welcome back, folks. And we brought Max back in. And how are you doing tonight, Max?
Doing very well, thank you. Thank you for having me on the show again.
It's been quite a while. I've been meaning to get a hold of you and see if you'd come back on and do another show.
Yeah, it has been a while since I've been on.
And I enjoyed our interview we had. It was something else. you got some new stuff going on?
Yeah, I got a big travel happening, actually. I'm taking off around the planet on Monday. I'm taking off to Peru on Monday and then going up through Costa Rica and over to Europe and doing a whole bunch of stuff through there. So all very surprising and kind of exciting. So, I'm leaving in 2 days from now. So I'm going to be off the air for about a month or at least a month and see where I go from there.
You're going to be appearing in conventions?
Look, I'm not really sure. I've got no commitments at this stage. It's just all this, I was sort of gifted this trip to Peru, and then I was contacted by a listener who heard me mention I was going to Peru, and they said, well, look, I'm in Costa Rica, so how about I fly you up here, and we go over to the World Hemp Expo in Slovenia. So I thought, okay, and then I had someone else say, well, while you're in Slovenia, well, you're only a hop, skip, and a jump from the UK, so I might as well go there. And so it ends up that I'm going all sorts of places. And it was just a trip to Peru to start with. And that was a surprise in itself. But now it sort of seems to have turned into this trip sort of halfway around the planet. So
yeah, I was going to say, it wouldn't take much to get all the way around.
Well, yeah, you know, just see where I end up. I might even end up in the United States yet. Possibly in October I might be in the United States. It's a high possibility. So
do you know? Do you know Brian Foster? He's in Peru. He does. He talks about the Almac tribe and elongated skulls that they found down there. I thought maybe that was what you were doing when you said Peru.
No, I just got invited over there to do 9 days in a healing retreat, raw food and all this sort of stuff. And I've also been invited to Cuzco and Machu Picchu to go and check them out. So I'm going to go and look at that sort of thing firsthand, which is going to be really good.
Oh, I hear that.
And Peru is an amazing place. It'd be really good to go there and see all this stuff firsthand. So, yeah, can't help but go. If I've been invited, I mean, it's a hell of a place to be. So, yeah, that's what I'll be doing for the next 2 weeks. So I'll be completely offline from Monday this week. I'll be going to Peru, and then I'll be into the jungle until probably the 12th of August at least. So that'll be 2 weeks that nobody hears from me at all.
Your website's thecrowhouse.com.
That's the one.
Yeah.
I've actually opened a travel blog on the website as well that I'll be updating. As, you know, when I have access to internet, I'll be posting pictures and travel information there so people will be able to keep track of my whereabouts.
Oh, that's good. I see you come on and off Skype all the time.
Yeah, well, you get that. The computer stays on all the time, but it won't be coming on much in the next couple of weeks, brother. I'll be way off in the jungle.
I don't blame you. I'd love to do it. I'd love to go to Peru, and especially Machu Picchu. I'd love to see that place.
Are you going to one of those ayahuasca rituals there in Peru?
I've been invited to one. Yeah, so we'll see how that goes. Very, very interesting. The whole synchronicity of my trip to Peru has been quite amazing, actually. So, yeah, it's definitely on the cards.
I just want to know if he needs a survival guide with him.
We've been joined by SJ.
Hi, gang. Hi, Max. Good to hear from you again.
I'm good. I'm well.
Well, last time we were talking about shared awareness and shared consciousness. What changes have you noticed?
Oh, look, I'm seeing a lot more people wake up. I'm seeing a lot more people become aware of what's going on. There's definitely a shift in consciousness. All the whole energy is changing. Be interesting to see what goes on with the Olympics this week with the whole opening ceremony ritual and all this sort of stuff. See what this does to the energy.
Yeah. Hey, I wrote you another haiku. You always inspire me to haikus.
So, anyway, Max, what do you think about this sudden and an overload of Planet X mania going on lately?
Is that going on again? I haven't really been noticing. Has that been going on again lately, the Planet X?
Yeah, for about the last 2 weeks, it's been absolutely insane. Of course, it's all tangled up with this massacre we've had over here in the States and the Olympics and missing nukes from South Africa. It's like the all the bolts are coming out of the wagon right now.
Yeah, look, I don't place any all of the Planet X stuff and anything celestial. I mean, I can't control that. If it's the reality, then there's nothing I can do about it. It serves me no purpose in concerning myself with it, because if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. And if I'm supposed to survive an event like that, then I'm sure the consciousness will put me in the right place at the right time to do so. If not, well, you know, that's just the way it goes. I mean, it's celestial. what do you do? It's just, yeah. Oh, my, we're going to have a planet collide with us. I better go and build a shelter in the backyard. I don't think that's going to work, folks, you know. It's just a celestial event. So it serves me no purpose in worrying about those sort of things.
Get your hard hat on, right?
Well, yeah, you know, it's kind of a big call, you know. It's sort of something beyond anyone's limitations or anyone's control. We've been
seeing a lot of strange things happen this last 6 months.
We've been seeing strange things go on the last 600 years.
Well, I'm at noticeable.
But with the whole Planet X thing, I mean, when you really look at the way the solar system works and you look at the whole heliocentric orbit sort of theory and all of this sort of stuff, you realize that we're not in a flat spiral the way the solar system's always depicted. You know, you've got the sun there and you've got these flat orbital planes and you've got, you know, Pluto on a bit of an elliptic orbit and all this sort of stuff, you know. People don't realize that the sun's moving through the galaxy at a phenomenal rate. So it's actually spiraling through the galaxy, and the solar system's spiraling after it. It's like it's towing the planets. You know what I mean? And we are millions and millions and millions of miles away from where we were yesterday. And so having a planet that's got this really big, vast elliptical orbit like Nibiru or Planet X is supposed to have doesn't really make a lot of sense. I mean, you know, when you can understand that it is like a corkscrew motion that we're having here, the way the solar system is functioning, right. All the planets are actually being towed by the sun. They're just revolving in a corkscrew as they do it. You know, we're not in this flat orbit the way it's depicted. So that puts a whole different perspective on it. Although I've got a lot of faith in a lot of Sitchin's work and the stories of the Anunnaki and all this sort of stuff, makes a lot of sense. But the whole Planet X thing, I mean, possibly a comet or something like that. There's definitely been some foreign body that came into this solar system that did a lot of damage, turned Uranus on its side, probably destroyed the planet that used to exist near the asteroid belt, probably did the damage that we now see done to Mars and all sorts of stuff. But whether it's this returning body, I mean, I just don't know. It's very, very difficult to find any real evidence of this. And when you start beginning to really understand how the solar system works and how the sun travels through the galaxy, it makes the possibilities of it pretty, pretty remote.
And everything works off spin.
Yeah, it makes it pretty remote. I mean, I think rather than saying that there's a reoccurring planet that's got an elliptical orbit, I'd say the danger that we're facing is simply because, I mean, if you want to look at, you know, from a celestial perspective, I'd say the danger we're facing is more because we are heading to a denser part of the galaxy. Like we're heading closer to the ecliptic, to the, you know, the ecliptic plane of the galaxy. And so it's very dense here. There's a lot of meteor activity. There's a lot of planetary activity. There's a lot more stuff going on. So it's more likely to have an impact from a comet or an asteroid or something like that. You know what I mean? So yeah. I don't know whether it's a reoccurring thing. I think it might just be our location in the galaxy that causes this sort of stuff.
Above the ecliptic plane's got more trash than below it.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Well, when you're in the center of the plane, you know what I mean?
Oh, somewhere in that area. Yeah, yeah. We've had an upswing on comets and some stuff like that the last few years, too.
Oh, yeah,
for
sure.
And there's even one scheduled that we're supposed to be able to see during the daytime, if I'm not mistaken, here shortly.
Yeah, well, you know, all of that sort of stuff is because we're at a denser place in the galaxy. You know, we're the closer we get to the ecliptic, the denser it is, the more activity there is, you know. Because the Earth, like the sun, when it travels through, like our whole solar system, when it travels around the galaxy, it's sort of going up and down like a horse on a carousel.
Right.
So it crosses that dense band like every 26,000 years or so. It takes 11,000 years to go up from the band and 11,000 years to come back down, or 11,600 or something like that.
I think it was Hawk that was saying he charted that there's mass extinctions when we hit the top of that.
Well, I think it's more probably when we hit the band, when we hit the central band, but somewhere along there, I mean, we have periods of mass extinctions, and we have periods of magnetic realignment as well. And when you think about that, like, you really think about it, when we cross the galactic plane, it stands to reason that the Earth could reverse its spin. It really does stand to reason that this could happen. I mean, if you go to the equator, and you get a bucket of water and you put a hole in the bottom and you hold it below the equator, just 10 inches or a foot below the equator, a few inches, you'll find that the water spins anti-clockwise as it pours out of the hole in the bottom of the bucket. And if you move it to 10 inches above the equator, it stops and it starts turning clockwise. And if you put it right on the equator, it just falls straight out of the bucket and doesn't spin. So...
Really?
That's just 10 inches. Just moving it 10 inches above that line of the equator, because that's the beginning of the North Pole and the South Pole. And North and South Poles, when you say poles, you're not talking about axial poles. You say North and South Pole, and people think of a pole going through the planet, and that's the axis. Now, we're not talking about the axis. We're talking about the pole, and the pole is related to magnetics. So when you put a bucket of water on the north of the equator, it spins clockwise. When you put it on the south of the equator, it spins anti-clockwise. And you've only got to move it 10 inches off the equator. So theoretically, it stands to reason that if the Earth is spinning in a certain direction now, when it crosses the ecliptic, there'll be a period of about 3 days as it passes that band when it will stop spinning. And then it will start spinning again in the other direction. Mm. And the polarity of the Earth will be reversed. And what north will become south, and south will become north. Doesn't mean the Earth flips upside down. It just means it's a polar reversal. You know what I'm saying? And right. It stands to reason that this could happen. And this could could attribute or account for the stories in the Bible that talk about the 3 days of darkness. And in lots of cultures, they talk about the 3 days of darkness on one side of the Earth and 3 days of light on the other side of the Earth. And wouldn't that also
put the oceans on the move? Much water.
Absolutely, it'd cause a bit of damage around the planet because if the Earth was to stop spinning, you know, there'd be a certain amount of seismic activity that probably would go with it, and certainly a certain amount of oceanic movement that would go with it as well. So it could be a very, very interesting time, but it's theoretically quite possible that this could happen when we cross the galactic plane.
Yeah, now that sounds reasonable to me.
That makes a lot of sense.
Does. See, it sounds more reasonable than what some other people have told us recently. Well,
well, as you think about it magnetically, you know, everything north is a magnetic north. Everything south is a magnetic south. It isn't a matter of pointing in that direction. It's a point of magnetism. And, of course, as above, so below, the same magnetism that applies to Earth, of course, applies to the sun. It applies to the whole solar system. And so, of course, it applies to the entire galaxy. We move down across the galactic ecliptic. It stands to reason that below the ecliptic, the rotation will be reversed, the same as the spin in water on the plane of this planet. So it all makes sense, you know, as above, so below.
Well, it does make you think about stuff. The spin theory stuff is kind of new. I've only seen a couple of YouTubes about it so far, and that's it. But a lot of them say that we don't even circle the sun, that we're just dragged behind it.
Well, we are. That's the thing. That's like I was saying, it's kind of we're corkscrewing. We circle it to a certain degree, but not really. Right. It's in front of us. It's dragging us through the universe, through the galaxy. Absolutely. We're being towed by the sun. It's just corkscrew motion that we're being towed by, you know?
I've kind of gotten a stressful argument with somebody else about this, but not necessarily an argument. This guy came on here trying to tell us, well, the sun on the other side is completely dark, and you gotta go, okay, well, then Saturn lighting up when it's on the other side of the sun. It's like, in my mind, it's like mixing 4D world and 2D world and leaving 3D world out. You know what I'm saying?
Well, the sun's rotating. I mean, we can look at it through the SOHO telescope, and we can look at it and we can see that it's rotating, so it's very doubtful that it's dark on the other side. You know, I mean, it isn't like it opens a curtain as it comes through or anything. I mean, it's obviously a ball and it's rotating, right. So I'd say that it's just what it is, you know.
Right, right, right. Yeah, I understand the spiral, how we're dragging through. I just, there's been some theories that got so far off the tack for me. It's like, okay, we're taking the theories of 4D and mixing it with Flatland. And it's like, okay, well, this ain't really working for me. I mean, maybe my mind's too tiny. I don't know.
Well, people tend to do that sort of thing. But, I mean, the sun is definitely a sphere, the same as everything else in the solar system, or except for asteroids. But most planets are spheres, and the sun is most certainly a sphere. And it's also based on the same, like the Merkaba. You notice that the sunspots all appear at 19.47 degrees latitude, north and south on the sun, which is the same points of the tetrahedron inside of Merkaba. You've got the circle with the dual tetrahedron inside, and the points where the extremities of the tetrahedrons touch the sphere are at 19.47 degrees. That's where the sunspots are. There's also an anomaly on every planet at 19.47 degrees. So it would appear that planets are functioning in the same way as a Merkaba is functioned. So, of course, they're spheres. They have to be spheres just to exist there in the vacuum. You know, right. There's no question about it.
Yeah, that was Hoagland that first come up with that tetrahedron theory, wasn't it?
Look, I'm not really sure. I couldn't tell you. I think it goes way back. I think you'll find that it exists way back in ancient cultures. I think that's the basis of the Merkaba. I think that's why the Merkaba design was created, to show you how reality works, because what you're seeing in the shape of a Merkaba is essentially the shape of a black hole. You're seeing the shape of contraction, and you're also seeing the shape of expansion. Because contraction, if everything contracts, I mean, they say the universe is expanding, they say planets are expanding, everything's expanding. So if the universe is expanding, then something must be contracting, because everything has an equal and opposite reaction. Everything has a polarity. So if the universe is expanding, then what's contracting? What's contracting is space. The vacuum is contracting. And when you really look at the shape, well, what's the shape of contraction? It's, well, the smallest volume you can possibly get is a tetrahedron. But if you try to balance a tetrahedron with the shape of expansion, which is a sphere, it's out of balance. So you need to insert another tetrahedron into it upside down. So you've got a dual tetrahedron, which is the shape inside the Merkaba, which is the shape of contraction. So in the Merkaba, you've got the shape of contraction, and you've got the shape of expansion. You know what I'm saying? So that's basically the shape of a black hole. That's the shape of the planets, because the planets are spinning. So the planets have to be hollow. All planets have to be hollow. The sun has to be hollow to a certain degree. The earth has to be hollow to a certain degree because of the centrifugal force of the spin. So you've got this expansion happening from the spin, and yet you've got the contraction of the vacuum at its center. So it's quite remarkable. And this is shown that this is the way it works, because you'll find an anomaly on every single planet. Even on Earth, you'll find the big volcano, the hot volcano on the big island of Hawaii is at 19.47 degrees. The red spot on Jupiter is at 19.47 degrees. The Cydonia complex on Mars is at 19.47 degrees. You know, the spot on Uranus is 19.47 degrees. Every single planet has got an anomaly at 19.47 degrees, and the line of sunspots you see around the sun, 19.47 degrees north and south. So this is obviously the way it works, and that's what the Merkaba is telling us, and that's why this was so pushed by the ancient cultures. While you find it everywhere, it's like ubiquitous. In almost all cultures, you'll see reference to the Merkaba, because they're trying to convey this information to us, I believe, anyway.
Do you think you'll find, in, say, like in Machu Picchu, some evidence that they agree with you on
the different
shape?
Different cultures, I don't know. Maybe I will. It depends on what's there.
See, it's a little different reading a book and looking at pictures and then going there and seeing it. You know, you see what I'm saying?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. I don't know how much reference of it there is at Machu Picchu of the Merkaba. There is certainly references at in other South American ruins of things relating to sacred geometry, things relating to the flower of life, which is all based on the 64 tetrahedron grid, which is all based on the Merkaba. So it's all related. I think the most fascinating things about the culture at Machu Picchu and the culture at Sacsayhuaman in Cusco is the structure of the stone, the structure of the buildings. I believe these buildings were made by softening stone. I talked about this in my book that I released in 2005, I think. The way these walls appears to have been made by softening stone. And there's actually plant extracts that you could use to do this. And that's what I think the most fascinating thing about that culture is. And what these cultures really say to us is that we are capable of much more. We had technologies back then that were both user-friendly and environmentally friendly. And we were able to achieve incredible things with these technologies. And we've had that taken from us. And now we live in this disposable, throwaway society. I think we've got a lot to learn from these places, and we need to pay attention to what they're trying to tell us.
Yeah, I believe we are in a throwaway society, you know, and I think that's one of the things that we need to change to survive as a human race. If we can get by what's some of the, if just one of these predictions that people have for what's coming up in the future take place, we're all in a bunch of trouble.
Well, we're in a bunch of trouble now. I mean, the problem with the throwaway society, the problem is that we've had our whole lives reduced to commerce. It's all about supporting the economic model. You know, we've got to support the economy. A strong economy is a strong country, which is a bunch of rubbish. You know, a strong economy means a dispossessed people. That's what it means, because the economy isn't there to support the people. It's there to support the system. The economy is you know, the fact that we support this bottom line and this economic model all the time. We base our whole structures on capitalism and consumption. We've trashed the planet. We've pushed everything towards supporting this economy at the expense of all the resources, the expense of all the people, and all we want is an efficient system, and we don't care about the people, you know. And that's what's wrong, you know. And we the people apparently created this whole system and this economy to service our needs. So how come the people are the most expendable thing within the parameters of the system? We need to shift our paradigm. We really do need to shift our paradigm from what's, you know, and figure out what's important. Because the economy isn't important. The economy is fiction. We made it up. It's a bunch of numbers on a screen. It doesn't mean anything.
How do you think is the best way we could change our future?
Well, we need to respect each other. You know, that's something we don't have. We need to respect each other, and we need to be 100% responsible for ourselves. We need personal responsibility. We've lost that. See, that's what freedom is. Freedom is self-responsibility. You know, you being 100% responsible and liable for everything you say and do, that is what freedom is. And a lot of people don't want that. And while they don't want that, they'll never be free. They want freedom without the self-responsibility that goes with it. They believe that they can pull down one corrupt government and pull another government there and say, now you look after my life for me, because these other guys didn't look after it for me and I want it looked after, but I'm not prepared to do it. You know, so, you know, we need to change that attitude with ourselves, and because until we do, we're going to be ruled, you know, because we're not capable of ruling ourselves, because we're scared of ruling ourselves. You know, we're terrified. Most people are absolutely terrified of self-responsibility. And they've been trained to be this way. You can't blame them for it. It's just the way they've been trained to be. But now we are having the system laid bare for all to see. And so with that now comes an opportunity to change the system. And the only way you can do it is with self-responsibility. Because we can see now what the system is. The system's designed to be responsible for you. It's okay, you do this, give us your insurance, you know, we'll look after you, we'll take liability for your actions. All you have to give us in return is all that you are. And we give that away willingly, and we let people run our lives because we don't want the responsibility of running it for ourselves. That's our problem, and we need to shift that paradigm with people.
I hear that.
I'm not one of those people, because I would be very happy in a world where there was no government and everybody was responsible for themselves.
I'm not one of those people either. I'm speaking collectively when I say that. But as a species, this is the way we generally are. This is the way our societies have structured us to be and structured our minds to think this way. So this is the dilemma that we face. Because it's only by shifting that paradigm that we'll ever find remedy to this situation. And so that's what we need to do, is we need to find an eloquent enough way of conveying this message to vast amounts of people.
I was going to say, you brought the economy into this. Could you go into that with the U.S. versus London's economy? Or?
Could you tell us who you are first?
Sorry, this is Major Tom. Sorry about that.
Thank you, Major Tom.
Well, look, I haven't really got time to go into that, mate. I've only got about 5 minutes left, I think. So.
Yes, sir. Sorry.
Do you think it'd be a good thing to have a world economy?
A world economy? Yeah. Look, depends on. I mean, not if it's based on anything like the current system. You know, and people. I mean, when you get into economy, it's so convoluted and so complicated. People don't even understand how money works, let alone understand the economy.
See, I hear that.
An economic system. I don't think we need a system of commerce. We don't need a system of commerce. We need a system of empathy, and we need to function from empathy in everything that we do. We've had the whole human experience replaced with commerce, whereby everything's got a dollar value attached to it, and we need to change that. We need to change our way of thinking. I don't know what the ideal economy would be, but I know the one that we've got doesn't work, because the one that we've got is basically designed to steal everything it can from the people. That's its whole purpose. It's an economy designed to put people in scarcity so that everything they own can be stolen from them. And we need to change that. And like, I'm no economist, so I can't really offer recommendations on what would be better. The best thing I've heard so far is Mike Montagna's mathematically perfected economy, but I still have trouble getting my head around that, because it's just all so convoluted. It's a very left brain way of thinking. I prefer more of a Vedic culture and a gift based society, because I think that if people were educated in reality, they'd want to give to each other. There wouldn't be all this need to profit from people. There wouldn't be all this need to accumulate wealth, because ultimately life is wealth. Life is wealth, and what you create in the world is wealth. What you give to the world is wealth. Your contribution is wealth. You know, I have a different concept of what wealth is. And I'd like to see money removed from the equation altogether. I can appreciate it would probably take a few generations for this to happen. But I think with proper education in reality and a
regular show up here shortly when you get back.
Not a problem. It'll be a couple of months, but I'll definitely come back on.
I appreciate it. We'll be right back, folks.